Hey, it's the announcement guy over here with my friend Stacy Butters, and we're talking a little bit about Youth Sunday. This year, it falls on a Sunday. Tell us a little bit about it.
Sunday, November 7th. We're here for both services. We get to feature some of our youth. My heart is so happy that Youth Sunday is happening.
We're going to have some fun, so be here that day. Here's what's coming up.
The moment I entered the doors of Mile High Church 18 years ago, I knew and I felt that I had found my spiritual home. We currently have one in-person membership class where you can get more connected and more involved with Mile High Church.
We want to honor all of our amazing volunteers at this year's Volunteer Appreciation event this Friday, October 29th. We will have fun entertainment and prizes for everyone, hosted by Reverend Jackie Harris and the ministerial team. The Mile High Church Bereavement Team invites you and your loved ones to attend our Grief Support Workshop, Navigating the Holidays. Designed to support you in creating a meaningful holiday season, the workshop is open to anyone who has experienced a significant loss of any kind. Navigating the Holidays is Saturday, November 6th.
So we hope you'll be here for Youth Sunday. It's a great way to get the family together, and families and people of all ages are welcome on Youth Sunday. It's fun. Good to have everybody back. Here's another Stacy. People are wondering, how many Stacys are there? God, every place I look, there's a Stacy. There's another Stacy right there. She's going to be a part of Youth Sunday, too. All right, so be here November 7th and bring the whole family.
Hello, Mile High. Happy Sunday to you. It's good to be here. I know it's really good for my heart and my soul today to be here with all of you. So we're going to get some... We're going to get you moving a little bit. We're going to get the energy going. And if you feel like you want to, like, stand up and kind of move into that energy a little bit, feel free to. And I'll meet you in the music.
You say, I know it's a waste of time. There's no use trying. So scared. Is that
Jennifer Burnett and the Mile High Band. Awesome.
Yeah.
Mile High Congregation. Awesome. Congratulations to you. Good to see you up and moving. Hey, Tom, how much money have we raised at the Pumpkin Patch so far? $45,000. It speaks to the power of spiritual community and how we do good for others. Tom and his team do most of the work, but we all get to take the credit. They created a pumpkin patch out there for Habitat for Humanity, and this year so far, over $45,000. So thank you, Mile Hires, for participating in that, and I know you're still open after service today. Hey, thank you, everyone, for continuing. Those who are at home, we love you. Here in the sanctuary, thanks for continuing to wear the mask. You know, I never want any of us to feel like this is normal, right? We don't want to get used to this, but we, you know, continue to watch those COVID numbers every week. The numbers are going down in the country, which is fantastic, but they kept going up here in Colorado, in particular here in Jefferson County, and they seem to be stabilized. They're about an average caseload of about 175 or so right now. We want to get the number below 125, which is very possible. We're prayerful about that so that we, you know, can make wearing a mask your choice when you come in here. But in the meantime, thanks for keeping yourself safe. Thanks for helping to keep everyone else safe. And thanks for being patient with us. We so appreciate all the support we get in this incredible spiritual community.
Yes, it's beautiful to be part of community, isn't it? Yes. And love each other and care for each other. So thank you for being a living demonstration of that. And part of what we also love to do as a community is to step into prayerfulness together. So we begin our service each week with an opportunity to be still, to go within, to sing together, have a little silence together. And so just take a breath with us today and let's lean into that space. Reverend Simon will lead us in a prayer. Let us begin.
Surely the presence of God is in this place. I can feel the mighty power and the grace. I can hear the brush of angel wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence God is in this place. Surely the presence of God is in this place. I can feel the mighty power and the grace. I can hear the brush angel wings, I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of God is in this place. And
so we turn from conditions. We turn from the various effects and situations of our lives. We turn from the busyness, the crowds, and the discord, and the roller coaster ride of everyday living. We turn from the news feed and the buzz feed and the insanity of social media. We turn into the center, the heart space, the awareness. We enter into high consciousness, and there we find the beloved. Spirit, God, the infinite, the absolute, the one source out of which all things arise. And I affirm this one source as the very essence and foundation of all that I am. And as I claim this as my truth, I likewise claim this as the truth of all beings. All creation arises out of that one source, the infinite mind, the infinite heart. Accepting that this is true, I likewise accept that there is a perfection that is ever available to each one of us. It is that perfection that is our inherent nature, and it is ever available. So as we turn from confusion, we find guidance. As we turn from heartbreak and disappointment, we find peace. As we turn from disharmony and discord, we enter into that space of love. We enter into that space of perfection which transcends our intellectual understanding, but nonetheless is continually making itself known in our lives, as our lives. Whatever challenges, whatever obstacles seem to be, we fall back on the peace, the harmony, the love, the beauty of our being. This is our truth. I affirm it, I claim it, I know it. And I'm so grateful for this work that we do in this community, for all the ways in which we say yes. For I know that the work that we do here is a blessing, and it ripples out beyond this community, just as I know all who are gathered in any way, on any day, to pray, to meditate, to acknowledge the divine. That work matters. And so I am grateful that we get to gather here in community and be about this good work. This is my truth. And I affirm that it is already achieved and fulfilled within the mind of God. And as such, I release it into the law, the creative process, affirming, yes, God, I believe. I believe it is done. And so it is.
Will this day I be a blessing? Will this year be better than the last? Will I calm the voice that hounds me? Discard the demons of my past? Will I step out in my faith now? Live the truth I've come to know? Throw my dreams into the river? And let these four words help them flow, singing, yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. Sing it with me now. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. I believe in your goodness. I believe in your grace. I believe that your power is flowing through me in this space. For you've given me. And you would not have said. set this flame in my heart if I could not start a fire. So yes, I believe. I believe. Yes, I believe. God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. Sing it out. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. One more time. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe. Yes, God, I believe.
Our words of inspiration today come from Veronica Tugaleva. No one needs to hit rock bottom to change, and yet so many people do, only because most of us are uncommunicating with ourselves. Stress, depression, anxiety, insomnia, headaches, illness, these are all symptoms of a bigger problem. You're trying to tell yourself something loudly. Listen now or listen later. There is no ignoring the call. And from Mile High practitioner Donna Danone, will your wounds serve a purpose? When we seek the nuances of what is held within our wounding, when we find ways to release what does not serve us, we bring about healthy change, learning the art of spiritual transformation. We find ourselves on an upward spiral, regenerating itself in greater and greater arcs of wisdom and insight. Our curiosity acts as a powerful intention, allowing us to shift from darkness into illumination.
Everybody pulling me in all kinds of directions, try to tell me what to say, how to think and feel. Truth is that every soul's continually searching. We think we know, but we got no idea. I'm a saint, I'm a sinner, I'm the sky, I'm the dirt. Human trying to figure out this place we call Earth. I'm a leader, I'm a rebel with an unknown plan. I'm a believer trying to figure out who I am. Then I see you and I've got nothing to hide. You're the only one who knows what's hurting inside. 'Cause you love me more than any perfect disguise. You never judge me and you never ask why. I'm a saint, I'm a sinner, I'm the sky, I'm the dirt. Trying to figure out who I am.
about this place we call Earth. I'm a leader, I'm a rebel with an unknown plan. I'm a believer trying to figure out who I am. I'm a saint, I'm a sinner, I'm the sky, I'm the dirt. I'm a human trying to figure out this place we call Earth. I'm a leader, I'm a rebel with an unknown plan. I'm a believer trying to figure out who I am. I'm a believer trying to figure out who I am.
Jennifer Burnett, our wonderful artistic director, key sync vocalist. Thank you so much, beautiful. She makes everything beautiful. And our wonderful band today, we have Rob and Kent and Josh and Bijou. Yes. So wonderful. Well, I'm truly enjoying our adventure in faith this year. I thank our wonderful team once again, and thank you to Sarah Shin for doing the reading this morning. She's one of the members of the team and also a great staff member here at Mile High Church working in our marketing department. So thank you to Sarah. Yes, great job. They came up with a wonderful theme for us this year. The slide's there, five gates to living now, an opportunity for us to walk through gates that are interior gates of beingness that allow us to fully inhabit this now moment just as it is, with all of its changes and new experiences and things we could have never predicted. And so we've been going through a number of those gates. Today is gate number 4. Today, the gate we're going to explore walking through is the gate of realness. It's about making real connections. And I felt so honored that the way that the speaking landed, that I also had a chance to speak on this theme today, because I can tell you in all honesty, I was a total expert in not being real for a very long time. So I know about this topic. I've had a real dance and journey with it. And so I'd like to share a little bit about my experience in that regard as a way to help us to consider how we could walk through that gate ourselves more often, more clearly, and more powerfully. So I was born into a family and had some family dynamics, especially with my father, where he was very controlling, I felt, of how I could express myself, what I was allowed to say, what I was allowed to feel, and most importantly, wasn't what I wasn't allowed to feel and say. Now, I can certainly blame or say that he contributed greatly to my initial decision to decide that I couldn't really be myself. But I also acknowledge that there may have been some spiritual pre-choice on my part at a soul level. There may have even been some genetic predisposition. But whatever it was, I spent a good part of my young life learning how to live, which meant that I became an expert at being what you, whoever it was in front of me, needed me to be. I figured out really quickly, okay, to stay physically safe, to be approved of and accepted, I can't be myself. That's not okay. Clearly, that's not what this game is all about. So let me figure out what's needed and I'll just become that. And I spent a good part of my young life, somewhat unconsciously, but very clearly developing that skill set. And the basic bottom line belief was that if I am who I really am, I can't be loved. I can't be accepted. And I also noticed that by taking on that life belief as I grew older, because of the way the law of attraction works and my fervent, passionate belief I couldn't be myself, I continued to draw into my experience in my young years in school, in my relationships, things and experiences that told me that was the truth. Experiences of rejection and intense criticism and bullying and things that continue to anchor in for me and put me behind that gate of realness, saying, I can only be loved if I'm not who I really am. And I have to develop some perfect image to present to the world so that I can be accepted. This was my journey to real living because it was very painful. It was very painful. As I grew older and continued to grow and develop in my consciousness, came into this church, entered into romantic relationships that fell apart, likely because I wasn't really being my real self, but hey, that's a whole other talk altogether. Went into eventually a marriage relationship, and then as I became a minister in the ministry that I got to serve in Scottsdale, I could feel that there was this intense desire in me to somehow step through that gate. That felt like that gate of realness was like this iron gate that was big and heavy. And every once in a while, as I grew personally and did therapy and became a practitioner and did work in ministerial school and did all that I could, I would peek out of the gate and maybe show up a little bit, and then I would close it fast right behind me and get back behind it just so I could be safe. And when I became a lead minister in this church, I had a motivation. I thought, I really want to be an authentic spiritual leader. I want to stand up in front of people and be real, be myself, warts and all, and face the potential of criticism and rejection, because it happens. I know I say things that piss people off all the time. I know that. That's just part of leadership, right? But I want to be authentic about that. I want to be authentic. I want to show people that they can do that, that I want to be an example for authentic living, and I want to be able to be loved and to feel love. And I also loved that this community that I was honored to lead for 17 years, the vision that was forged for the community, I didn't forge it. It was through the minister prior to me who founded the community. Founded it in an intention that if we as a spiritual leader in the church, the ministers, the practitioners, the staff, the key volunteers, were to fervently practice being real and authentic with each other in a loving way, that that would communicate to the community and be a living example of how people could live. So I was faced with doing this profound work. And the thing that really took me to my knees with this issue became the reality that as long as I put out an image of myself for the world to see, and people choose to love that image, I can't ever really feel love. I can't ever really be loved. I can't ever really be seen. I'm not a real person. I'm just the image of me out there. And out of my desire for all of that authenticity to express itself, and out of my desire, which I think every human has, to be loved, to be seen for who we really are, I decided that I would walk out of that gate forever, and that I would practice to the best I could being as real as I could. I wasn't and am not still always perfect at it. I'm still tempted sometimes to put forth some false image of myself to impress someone or make someone think something about me, but I catch myself doing it now more than anything. And what I've also noticed is that in that community and in my personal life and in this community, that the more I put myself out authentically, the more people love me. It was a very interesting shock. Now, not everyone loves me. I get that. Not everyone thinks I'm the bee's knees, but I felt real love for the first time in my life because I was loving myself enough to show up and not just be some version of myself. What I discovered is that the real me equaled real love. And it was real, authentic love. I love that in that beautiful book called The Velveteen Rabbit, there's a quote there where one of the characters says, because once you are real, you can't be ugly except to people who don't understand. And so while I acknowledge that being real and authentic doesn't always mean that people don't criticize us or reject us or don't maybe they even disagree with us fervently, what I'm standing here saying is that being real, being willing to be real, is a key element to making a connection to the inner aspect of ourselves that we seek to express in the world and is a key to being connected to people. And I think it's also a key to ushering forth the kingdom of heaven that we all yearn for. And that most people want to be real. We want to be loved and seen, and we want to be able to express ourselves fully. And we see throughout history as groups of people struggle to come out and be who they are and show themselves to the world. And even in those countless stories of struggles to come out and say, I choose to live my life in this way, and here's who I choose to love. Not everyone agrees with the choice, and not everyone can go with us on the choice, but the reward for real living and being real is the fullness of ourselves. And I can say, after all these years in ministry, standing at the bedside of someone who's about to pass away, their ruminations about their death are very rarely, well, I didn't work enough, and I didn't make enough money, and I didn't travel the world enough and see enough things. Often the greatest pain that I see and hear from people who are about to die is, I didn't choose to be myself. I didn't choose to share who I am with the world. I didn't choose to be my authentic self, and I regret that. Today, the gate we're inviting us all to walk through is a regretless willingness to be our authentic self. Now, it may not be that at first we choose to do that everywhere. So I want to say that what I noticed when I made that choice and began to walk that path, I had to at first choose relationships that I really could trust, that I could show up and say, okay, I'm going to take the risk and I'm going to be myself here. And it took a little learning how to communicate and be my real self in those environments and step fully into it. But what I've discovered is that when I did that, I released greater energy into my life. And just like when I wasn't being my real self, I was attracting situations into my life that encouraged me not to be my real self. The minute I began to make a new choice, what began to come into my life were people and opportunities who were in alignment with who I am. And so things just kept getting, like being myself just kept releasing more energy into the world and into the law on my behalf, saying, okay, I'm going to be me and I'm up for it. I'm going to be me and I'm ready. I'm going to be me and I'm going to step into my full living, my fullest living. And that was a powerful, powerful thing to see. But it was also an opportunity to grow at the deepest level of my being. So I started small with people that I trusted, and I began to have the circle grow. And I also noticed something really important that I want to lean into here in the second part of my talk. And that is that in being my real self, sometimes I felt like a child. A toddler. I mentioned being a toddler last week. I felt that way at first too, because I think what can happen is in our initial attempts, if we've been stuffing ourselves for a long time down into the box or behind that gate, our initial attempts when we first come out can be very awkward and uncomfortable, and also full of what I call our ego self. It's a decision where we say, I'm going to be me, all of me, gosh darn it, and I'm going to share with the world what I think. And some of us mistakenly think that means now I tell everybody my opinion of them. Right?
of what they're doing, of what they're saying, of what they're doing. Hey, I gotta be real with you. I don't agree with you at all. Hey, I gotta be real with you. That's stupid. Hey, I gotta be real with you. You are an idiot. That's not what I'm talking about. But that can be kind of that egocentric understanding. It's kind of a misunderstanding, an emotional and spiritual immaturity that says if I'm going to be me, that means that I now have a right to tell the world all about me. And so it's egocentric. Now, I don't personally happen to be one of those people who thinks that the ego self of us is all bad. In fact, I don't think anything or anyone is all bad or all good. It's just that the ego can be something we can use in balance and can be a very beautiful aspect of ourselves. Because we came here to Earth to be spirit in expression. That's something we all share. We are all God in form, but we are each a unique way in which God expresses. And the ego aspect of ourselves is the part of our psyche that can distinguish ourselves from each other and make choices that distinguish ourselves from each other and say, well, I'd like to go here. And someone else might say, I'd like to go there. And we say, great, have fun. I'm going. It's a complete tool, a wonderful gift that we have. But what's happened in our world is that we've become over-identified with ego self. And especially, I think part of what some of the uncomfortableness with the new now that has formed and fashioned itself over these number of years is that the ego self is rampant in our world right now, as people feel that the only way we can save ourselves is to shout out loudly to each other where you're off track and where you're off track and where you're off track. Where you should be seeing it differently. In his prayer, I loved how Reverend Simon mentioned the insanity of social media and how people will go onto social media and not even be a real friend, be you could call it a fake friend, a friend that you don't even know, but still feel that they have a right to comment and share their opinion about what you should be doing and how you should be thinking and what you're doing wrong and how you're thinking about it wrong and what you should believe and what political party you should be a part of and what religion you should be a part of and what how people feel like they have that right, right? That's ego realness. That's the part of us that says, hey, I'm going to be real with you even if it hurts. You should know that Jesus Christ is the only way and you are off track, right? That's part of what people do. Some of us do that too. When we interact with people, we have strong beliefs about something and we think, well, I got to set them straight. They're in the wrong political party. They're in the wrong religion. They're in the wrong relationship, and I'm going to tell them all about it. I'm going to be real with them because they need some real talk. That's the ego self. That's the part of us that thinks that we're right, that can be very arrogant, that can project onto the world that if everyone would just do it our way, everything would be fine. And our ego really sometimes thinks that. If kids these days would just do it the way we did it in my generation, everything would be fine, right? These overgeneralizations are part of an extension to try to say, I'm going to be my real self, but it becomes somewhat of a weapon because the motivation that's underneath it is never connection, it's separation. The motivation that's underneath it is never love, it's force. The motivation that's underneath it is not an opportunity to come together and share and be together in a place of authenticity where I express myself and I listen to you. It's all the ego's need to be heard and be seen. And it's not working for us. What I've noticed about being real is I will never create connection with other people by judging them and making them wrong. I will never create connection with other people through separation. It just can't happen. Meanwhile, underneath, the God self of us is urging us and we're craving connection. And so how do we have what I'm calling real connection by sharing with people and being with people? What it requires of us is an intention, first of all, to step out of that
through that gate into being my real self, and understanding that as I am my real self and everyone else on the planet is their real self, God is more fully realized, even when the real selves over there don't believe what I believe. I often use the example of this teaching. I love this teaching. I'm passionate about this teaching. This path is my spiritual path and has been for 40 some years. I love it. I'm passionate. I want to teach it to everybody. I want to tell anybody about it who wants to know. I want us to fling the doors open wide and let anybody who resonates with it to come in. But there's no way that I absolutely believe that every person on this planet should believe what we believe right here. I don't believe that, because I don't think that's how God works. I don't think that's how the universe works. It'd be like saying there can only be one flower in the garden of life. I get to pick it. It's a rose, right? How boring would that be? How anti in alignment with nature would that be? But that's what we sometimes want to do. There should only be one political party in this country, and I know the one it should be, right? There should only be one religion in this country, and I know the one it should be. There should only be one way that people can be in loving relationships and marriage, and I know what way it should be. No, that's not how it works. That's not how nature works. That's not how God works. That's not how humanity works. That's not how we work. It is in no way, any way near the way we work and the way we are most expressed in the world. It's absolutely the opposite. It's this path is totally right for me. I love this path. And I am pretty sure that upon my death, I'm going to discover that there were things about this path that I was wrong about and we were wrong about. You know, the universe will unveil its secrets at some point, and there's probably some percentage of it that we got right, and there's some percentage of it we're going to go, oh gosh, we didn't get that part right at all. And it's true of everything. And the people who understand this can live that way and be real in all of their relationships and understand that one of the secrets that I can tell if I fall into divisiveness, I fall into beliefs that say the only way the world can be saved is through overgeneralizations. And in those moments, I've lost my connection to myself and all other beings. And the only way we find the kingdom of heaven is to be in our passion and be ourselves and be willing to say, here's how I see it. Tell me more about how you see it. I'm going to be passionate about science of mind, but I'm not running over to the Christian college next door and dragging all of those kids over here and saying, you guys got to come here. We have to say, for gosh sakes. I'm going to send them love and prayers and know they're finding God there in their way. May not be my way, but it's their way. And I know that this can feel dangerous to us, especially in our world now, because we feel like the stakes are high. That if people don't do what we think they should do, the virus could proliferate. You know, we could get each other sick. The world could fall apart. Democracy could die. We've got all these big platitudes about all this stuff that could happen. But that's the ego part of us who's whispering its fear to us constantly. If we don't have the right political party in leadership, we could all die. That's what the ego says. It's not right. It's not correct. It's not the truth. The truth is that we are on a constant evolutionary journey. And what will truly cause our world to flourish is when we are lovingly with each other as God lovingly accepts each one of us. For God, the infinite life is fully expressed in every single being, even in that other political party that you don't like, even in those other religions that you don't like, even in those other countries that you're afraid of or you don't like. God is there too. And when I recognize that, I can stand in front of someone and share myself, share my light, share my fear, share my emotions and thoughts, and let them do the same. And in that realness, walking through that gate together and standing with each other instead of separating from each other, we build a new world together. I want that new world. I am a stand for that new world. And I'm inviting us to step into it today. In this week ahead, I'm inviting us to ask ourselves questions about some of our most important relationships. How could I allow myself to be more connected? What could I do to create more authenticity in my relationships? How could I listen more, especially to the people that I disagree with? How could I hear more of other people's ideas in the media or in areas that I feel passionate about? How could I be more connected? How can I bring my God self and my authentic self in a soft way to the relationships that I love the most? How can I share myself and allow other people to share themselves with me in a way that's authentic and real? And I think if we look at our lives, we'll find that the more realness that there is, that soft realness that allows each other to be who we are, the more love is unleashed into the world, the more peace is unleashed into the world. On September 7th, my wonderful mother, who's here today, hi Mama, Linda, and I were with her beautiful husband, Richard, as he passed away into the next life. We held his hand as he slipped the leash into the next experience. And he was a great man. And he worked very hard in his personal life to be an authentic man, to be real, and to open his heart up to her and to me and to all of us in his lifetime. And he did a magnificent job. He had strong principles and strong ideals about our world. He was very passionate about solar energy in the world and really wanted us to, as a world, begin to embrace solar power to help save our planet, was really into the ecology of our planet. And he was also full of heart and connection. And I'd like to close today with a poem that he wrote in 1993 called Connection. And we shared it at his memorial service. And I invite you to get quiet as I read it today, and right after I'm complete with it, we're going to pray together for real connection in our lives. But here are Richard's words. I've been hydroplaning over my feelings, hardly ever pressing down hard enough into the present moment to make contact with my truth. Hydroplaning on my doing, moving so fast that the rush of events forces the disconnect from myself, my being. At this speed, connection with my underpinnings is almost impossible, and my direction is dictated not by who I am, but by events that slide me one way or the other. Momentum has more to do with where I'm going than my dreams. But if I slow down and sink into my authentic self, alignment begins. Touching my reality, I'm jolted by the impact. Light as it may be, tears mark the contact. And my life starts to follow the truth of who I am. So we give thanks for this opportunity to consider leaning into the truth of who we are with great grace and love and light. I invite our practitioner prayer partners to stand with me in this prayer, wherever they may be, as an acknowledgement of our spiritual community anchoring ourselves this day in this divine realness, in centered realness, allowing ourselves to go forth in love and light and gentleness with ourselves, allowing us to step through that gate and make real connections this week, allowing us to do so easily and effortlessly, allowing us to choose to share our hearts and to listen and to recognize that a huge part of the spiritual intention of being this human that we are is to allow beautiful, meaningful connections and conversations. That real connections often come one-on-one, in small groups, in places and in situations where we can not only share who we are and what we believe, but welcome the sharing of who people are and what they believe. That value, that huge value that says, not only do I want this for myself, but I want this for all others. And that I'm confident that to the degree that we have that, we can create peace on earth, goodwill towards all. And that we choose to be a channel for such good this day, today, and in the days ahead. We choose to bring forth and be that authentic self, to know that that light that shines brightly is in each one of us, uniquely expressed. We are it, we live it, we are real, we are connected. And I'm so grateful that this is the truth of us now. As I release this word into the action of that law that makes it so, I simply let go in faith and confidence, knowing it is done. And so it is. Amen.
It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up both your eyes. We cannot. Without ever knowing how, it's in every one of us here and now.
Thank you, Jennifer Burnett. You're bringing it at all different levels today. Thank you very much. It's rare that we get to do this. Let's hear this for hear it for Michelle Medrano and that incredible message. Thank you. Everyone, today is our Volunteer Recognition Sunday. We are always grateful for our volunteers, but I am particularly so grateful for each and every one of you starting in March of this year when we started coming back into the sanctuary from COVID. Haven't they been incredible? Their studiousness, their professionalism, putting their own health at risk to help create this safe environment for us. We're so grateful for them. And I'm so grateful for our staff leadership in that area, Ken Nakamura, and this incredible woman right here, Reverend Jackie Harris.
Thank you. It's truly an honor and a privilege to work with these volunteers at Mile High Church. They show up. They're fun to be with. In fact, if you have an opportunity today, please see Rion. He is, I'm going to say, mocking.
Lovingly
mocking his good friend Scott. You'll have to check it out. There he is in the back. And this is the kind of love we have within these volunteers. They love each other, they support each other, and not that they're perfect, but I just love working with them. That's just really a privilege. So I have two of our volunteers here with me this morning. Scott Shaw, who is one of our usher leaders. He was an usher leader in the 12 o'clock service. He has now come into the 10 o'clock service. He's been with us a long time. He's got a huge, good heart. And he's leaving us next weekend and going to Palm Springs. And that's the mecca of golf, so I may visit him while he's there. I love Scott, and next to him is Mark Lewis. Mark has been very active in many areas of the church. He is a practitioner also, but I think what he really shines in is his youth work. He teaches the fourth and fifth graders. God love you. That was my first angel job, was in the fifth grade, so I remember those ages. And he also works with us in our camps. So he is the archery man in Rainbow Day Camp, and he also does wilderness. So these are two of the extraordinary people who are part of our volunteer team, and they need extra acknowledgement. And you know, I got so excited about Scott going to the golf mecca, I forgot to say that my friend Mark is going back to my homeland, Virginia. He's going to the southeast portion of Virginia. And I will tell both of them there are centers for spiritual living in both of those locations. So I just want to say how wonderful it is for the support of our volunteers. I want to also tell you that this Friday, anyone who volunteers, we have a volunteer appreciation event in our community center. We're not serving food, but we're not on Zoom. We're going to have, we're going to have gift bags for each person who attends, so please come. It's 6 to 7. We'll have some entertainment, and the other ministers will be there supporting this event. So I really encourage all of you to come. If you are really enthused now to begin volunteering, you may see Ken Nakamura out in the hall or myself, or you can go online and you can sign up for a volunteer activity. But I send all my love to all of you, but I especially send it to those of you who volunteer. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Reverend Jackie. And in the midst of all this bounty, I invite us just to breathe it in, because truly our organization is so well supported by those who serve and volunteer and give their time and energy to us. So we are truly blessed. And I invite each one of us to become present to the abundance that flows through our life, to the way that life serves us, to the good that flows into our lives. Whether you're choosing today or to give financially or not, this love offering and abundance is all about getting present. So as we go through the activities of the love offering this morning, I invite us all to give into this space a wonderful sense within ourselves of gratitude for the good that flows through our life. If you are giving, you can do so by texting to give. You can go to the website. You can drop a check in or a gift in the basket or out there in the baskets in the lobby. You can send one in. Any of those ways work. We are so grateful for that. And so as we are present to that abundant nature in our lives, let's say our affirmation together. So please say with me, divine love as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, and all that I circulate. And so it is.
Never give up, no, 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 no. And I won't.
to get me down. I'll keep getting up when I hit the ground. Oh, never give up, no, never give up, no, no, no. And I won't let you get me down. I'll keep getting up when I hit the ground. Oh, never give up, no, never give up, no, no. Oh, I'll find my way, find my way. Oh, 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 I'll find my way, find my way. Oh, 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 I'll find my way, find my way. Oh, 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 I'll find my way, find my way. Oh, oh, oh.
Terrific. If you are new to Mile High Church, welcome. If you're here in the sanctuary, I'll be in our Welcome Center, which is just in the middle of the lobby after service today. I'll be there with some other incredible volunteers. We'd love to meet you. And if you're new and watching online, there's an I'm New tab there at milehighchurch.org, and please learn more about us. And we're not that hard to find, are we, Michelle, if you want to know more? Our incredible prayer practitioners are making their way to the front of the stage, so if you would like to make a real connection in prayer today, please see one of them for an affirmative prayer.
And we want you to know of some things that are happening coming up this week. We are blessed to have our Harvest of Love food drive ending today. If you'd like to participate in dropping some food off right after service, you can do so over in the community center. Thank you to all of you who have donated already. We're so happy to be supporting communities right here in our very own community. And then we also want you to know that new member class is happening today. I'm looking at Reverend Zamira here. She's having a class right at 11:30 over in the community center in room D. The new member class is a great class if you're brand new to come and find out more about our community, all that's available to you in the community. And if you choose to join and become a member, you can learn more about that. And she can tell you all about it. So please join Reverend Zamira for that. And again, don't forget our volunteer activity Friday night, the wonderful event. I think we're the entertainment, aren't we? Yeah, we're going to dance.
We're ready.
We have a tap dance. We've been working on it for weeks, so you'll want to be there. So volunteers, come and let us acknowledge you, okay? This Wednesday night, I'll be talking about the gifts of uncertainty. So if you've been struggling with uncertainty in your life, Buddhism has some great gifts to teach us about that. So it's the second part of the series. Let's stand together now, please, and join me for the benediction and peace song. We go forth in love and light, choosing to be real, experience the realness of our truth. As we live out our lives this week ahead, we are so blessed. We let it be, we let it go, and so it is.